Good morning, Smita. Very, very warm welcome to Bharat Shakti.
Thank you.
The very first edition. Thank you for supporting the movement. So you are the addiction counselor, but we would like to interview you a little bit on your familiarity with the social media medium.
Okay.
But first of all, considering the fact that the role of the media is to inform and shape public opinion, I want a few comments first on what is your opinion on the state of the mainstream media in India today.
I think the advent of the social media has changed the power dynamics. Earlier, you only had the mainstream media. Mm-hmm. That is where you got all your information and you consumed whatever was given to you. Social media has changed that in multiple ways. A, there is a power dynamic, so you don't have the media stars are fighting for their turf in a way, which is why you see this play out in the social media space as well, where sometimes media stars also act like trolls.
Correct.
And the only reason I can explain it is a sense of perhaps insecurity. Changing a status quo situation is never comfortable for the people involved, right? Social media has been beneficial in many ways. A, it has democratized the whole process of communication. Earlier, they gave you information, you consumed it, and there was no way to know whether that was accurate or not. Now there is instant rebuttals. You read something, social media gives you the counter view, it gives you diverse opinions, and also it's not only between, you know, social media talking back to the mainstream media. Social media, people talk among themselves, so there's exchange of ideas. The whole fact that we have a Bharat Shakti festival today is because a lot of us met through social media.
That's
so the networking
right.
is amazing.
Yeah. But given that, it is all, one gets the feeling sometimes mm-hmm. that social media has also factionalized in the sense that are we at some point, especially when the issues are rather polarizing, have we actually got into the habit of talking to echo chambers where we sort of congratulate a good tweet or a good report and that other side, are we changing opinion in any way or are camps talking to camps?
I think you've raised a very important point because I have spoken before about echo chambers mm-hmm. and to me that is self-defeating. The whole purpose of having the social media space, the reason it took off was because you had alternative points of view. But now, increasingly over time, I've been in the social media space now since end 2012. And in 2018 now, I see the camps have become entrenched and people only tend to talk to each other. And that's unfortunate because you're only hearing the kind of opinion that you wish to hear. What happens to the other chatter around? And if you're not open to that, then you're closing yourself. You're just operating in silos.
But I would again like to go back to mainstream media, but now in the context of all of them having their own, say, pages and Twitter handles,
mm-hmm.
Are they doing anything different or are they just furthering the same discourse and the same dialogue via their tweets and their posts? Are they using the social media format differently than they use their mainstream platforms?
I think a lot of the mainstream media stories are being picked up from social media.
Okay,
because for instance, I have the Times of India at home as a cosmetic feature, just because I'm used to it. It goes back sometimes unopened into the kabadi.
Okay.
And you know, because the news that I read on the front page is already old news. I've read it last night. Or the opinions on this, the debate has already happened on social media. So I think a lot of us hold on to these traditional media formats just for a sense of comfort. But that's eroding out because the younger generation, I don't see them read newspaper. A lot of them don't watch television. So the whole communication dynamics has changed. Snapchat, WhatsApp, you know, all these other mediums, Twitter, Facebook, these are the new means of communication. These are the new means of information gathering and exchanging.
So when it comes to, because it is such a democratic setup, you have a lot of anonymous handles that mm-hmm. actually are playing a very important role in disseminating precise information.
That's
or
right.
rebutting something that has been claimed which is wrong.
That's right.
So that also is an influence that is new to the information world. Would you say that?
Yes.
Yeah.
In fact, there are quite a few handles. True Indology is the one that comes to the top of my head. And there is a lot of pressure, if you notice, if you follow
right.
it closely enough, for them to reveal the identity. Where do you think that's coming from? If you reveal your identity, then we can target you in various ways personally. And then we can endanger your existence online. So I have said this before and I repeat, your engagement on social media cannot be defined by other people. You have to work according to what works for you personally. So if you're in a sensitive job or you're in a location which is sensitive and you can't say certain things, then please be anonymous. There is no shame in it. If you use your anonymity to be offensive or abusive or troll people or, you know, stalk people, it's a different ball game altogether. But if the anonymity is your cloak to enable you to get your message across more effectively without endangering yourself, then by all means, I think, go ahead and, you know, use an anonymous DP.
So to conclude, I just wanted to ask, as consumers, you know, today we are starting from literally putting our personal lives on display for other platforms like Facebook and Instagram to getting addicted to instant gratification or instant responses. Mm-hmm. I would like to know your point of view on what are the signals one must be aware of to understand that this addiction to is getting a little bit pathological, if one may use the term.
You know, people use the term addiction. It's as a addictions counselor, I can't use the word lightly, you see, because addiction means a certain diagnostic criteria. I would say there is a lot of social media dependence. And that dependence acts out in many ways, because when you disengage from the social media forums, there is withdrawal. And, you know, there's this sense of vacuum in people's lives. They become used to the high that a like gives you. You know, at the end of it, we're social creatures, we're human beings, and we like being appreciated. We need validation. And social media gives you that instant high, that instant like, the instant group appreciation. And for some people, that becomes the entire means of their existence. You know, they need that next high from the validation. That becomes, in fact, sometimes problematic, because then you tend to stick to your echo chambers, because that's where you will get your validation from. That also sometimes means that you engage very aggressively with other people, because then there are other people egging you on, you know, making a hero out of you. Or you engage in ways which is just attention seeking. There is no value add to the conversation that you're doing. So I would recommend to everybody that take some time to do a reality check. Disengage from social media every few months. Go see the real world outside, because that's completely different. Everyone's not fighting with each other. There is no catastrophe happening every day, right? Yes. So once you get that reality check, then you come back, engage at a more, you know, a normal pace.
Basically, we have gone into this era of mass connectivity and mass information, and everybody is a little bit like a Tower of Babel situation. So in all of this, is truth coming out sooner, coming out later? Are all sides of the truth getting space? What do you think is winning in this entire forum?
It's hard to say what is winning. All I can say is information overload is winning, for sure. And I think the challenge in today's world is not lack of information. It is too much information than having to sift out what is relevant to you. That is correct. One. And secondly, what is true and what is false? True. Because you can have an image which is just blasted out there, and if it connects somewhere, it goes viral. But very often we find that that image
correct
is not true. Or it's an old image which has been used in a different context to manipulate the news. And it's very fashionable to say that that game is played only in the social media field, but actually even mainstream media is doing that. Political groups are doing that. So, you know, as a consumer, it is very important to verify. If I've seen something and it seems too good to be true, maybe I need to check a few other sources. Maybe I need to wait a little to see how this conversation plays out before I jump in and give my inputs. For example, recently there was a story about this cart, you know, the vegetable vendor from Assam, who apparently adopted this little girl who he found abandoned. And therefore, you know, that he became his entire life. He didn't marry, he gave up his whole life to bring her up. And obviously it's a feel-good story. The story went viral. And then it turns out that it was a hoax. the card seller's image was from somewhere else, the girl was somebody else, and you know, there was no link to reality. So that does damage, because very often then true stories get viewed upon with suspicion. But at the end of the day, information is always going to be out there. It is for the consumer to take a step back and say, okay, fine, do I want to believe this, or do I want to be a little more discerning?
And ultimately, last, because considering elections are coming up, do you think that this overload of information can influence, or are people decided when it comes to votes?
See, it's very difficult to say that, you know, what decides votes eventually. It's all region specific, right? The discourse in the metros is different from the discourse in the tier 2 and 3 cities. Social media is a voice amplifier. And also the way it exists today, a lot of the social media is very urban, very English speaking. Mm-hmm. WhatsApp is a different ballgame, but when I'm talking about Twitter or even Facebook, and also people assume that a lot of the conversation is political, especially for people who are in the Twitter field. But on Facebook, if you actually go, a lot of the conversation is not political. It's about jokes. It's about sharing human stories. It's about, you know, family functions. Again, I repeat, it is a voice amplifier, but the impact on the ground eventually is dependent on a lot of other factors.
Okay. Thank you so much for your inputs.